Tonight on Mugshots, it was like The Sopranos, only real. The story of Sammy the Bull Gravano.
He said they're coming after me. That can make you shake in your boots a little.
John Gotti's underboss and turncoat.
I participated in 19 murders.
He took people's lives. He became God.
Arizona businessman.
Sammy talked about putting together his own organized crime family, the Arizona Mafia.
And eventually, a bald-headed and broken man on his way to hard time in a supermax prison. Before dawn on February 24th, 2000, a Phoenix Police Department SWAT team burst into this apartment in Tempe, Arizona, through the front and back doors and arrested Sammy the Bull Gravano.
They flash-banged his apartment with concussion grenades. He was on the floor crawling towards his guns.
This is what Sammy the Bull looked like on the day of his arrest for distributing the drug ecstasy.
A particularly vicious drug. Synthetically made, mostly in Holland. It has a hallucinogenic properties. It has stimulant properties, unlike other drugs designed and marketed to our youth.
And this is what Sammy the Bull looked like 2 years later. Nobody in law enforcement expected to see Sammy the Bull Gravano in court again as a defendant. Gravano was, in fact, the nation's most famous government witness against organized crime.
In January of 1990, I accepted the position of official underboss, which I held until I began to cooperate with the government in 1991.
To understand how he ended up in a Phoenix courtroom, you have to return to his roots in Bensonhurst, Brooklyn. Salvatore Gravano was born in 1945. He was raised in this house. He used to walk past this corner on the way to church. It was a corner where mob guys hung out. When Sammy was 10, he desperately fought two older boys to retrieve his stolen bike. One of the mob guys watched it happen and said, "You see that Sammy? He's like a bull." The nickname stuck.
Bensonhurst was Italian. You know, you walk through the streets today, it's different. Back then, if you didn't speak Italian, you had to point at things in the store because, you know, you weren't going to get what you needed.
Michelle McPhee covers the mob for the New York Daily News as the paper's police bureau chief. She's the author of Mob Over Miami and is currently at work on a book about the mob in New York.
The mob was seen as a way to keep the neighborhood safe. It kept the druggies and the thieves and the undesirables out of the neighborhood.
Brooklyn, like other parts of New York City, was controlled by various organized crime groups. Outsiders referred to them as mafia families. Insiders used the Italian phrase, la cosa nostra, our thing. And there was a brutal and deadly side to these mafia families. They controlled gambling, loan sharking, prostitution, and extortion. And when someone crossed them, their response was often swift and lethal. When Sammy was growing up, the neighborhood mobsters fascinated him.
Sammy the Bull would go to church on Sundays with his family and look at these dapper guys on the corner, and you know, everybody would seem to pay them a lot of respect. And when Sammy the Bull asked his dad, like, who are they? His dad would say, they're our people, but those are not people that you want to be around. And of course, that just intrigued him all the more. And those are the very men that he wanted to be like.
Sammy's parents wanted their son to stay in school. They saw education as a key to success. But Sammy was determined to make a name for himself on the tough streets of Brooklyn. It was there that he got the respect and power he craved.
It was in this neighborhood, on corners like this, that Sammy the Bull first got a start as a tough guy. He was a member of a gang called the Rampers, and the Rampers functioned solely to sort of protect this turf. And this is really where it all began for him.
By now, Sammy was at New Utrecht High School in Brooklyn.
He landed here as a teenager, and didn't last long. He got into battles and beefs and fights and pretty soon was kicked right out of school.
Sammy never graduated from high school. From 1964 until 1966, Sammy was in the Army. When he returned home to Bensonhurst, he began working with members of organized crime. During this same period of time, John Gotti was making a name for himself as an associate of the Gambino crime family.
Sammy the Bull became close friends with John Gotti. So these were two young guys that had already proven themselves to be not only tough, but able to keep their mouths shut. And those were exactly the kind of recruits that the Gambino family was looking for, and these guys became a crew.
By 1977, both Gotti and Gravano were made men, official members in the Gambino family, one of the most powerful mafia organizations in the nation. Their boss was Paul Castellano.
Paul Castellano was a very old school don. This guy hailed from the mob back in Sicily, and one of his rules was no drugs. Castellano knew the drugs would be the downfall of the mafia as he knew it. But now, one of John Gotti's underlings had been caught moving weights of heroin. They were in trouble. His crew was in bad right now with Paul Castellano, and they knew it. And they decided to do the unthinkable. They were going to rub out Paul Castellano, one of the biggest, most powerful bosses in New York City.
On December 16th, 1985, Gotti and Gravano made their move to kill their boss. The place they picked was Spark's Steakhouse on West 46th Street in the heart of Manhattan.
John Gotti, I, along with some others, murdered Paul Castellano. We took over the family. John Gotti became the boss. In January of 1990, I accepted the position of official underboss.
John Gotti was the boss. He was the face man for the family. Well, Sammy the Bull, he was the guy who carried out the orders.
And if the boss's orders called for murder, Sammy the Bull made sure it was done. Eddie Garofalo, the groom in this home movie, fathered three children. He had his own construction company. In order to operate his business in New York, he had to kick back a percentage of his profits to the Gambino family, which controlled much of the construction industry in the city. A dispute between Gravano and Garofalo over money led to his murder.
I did know there was tension between Gravano and my father. He did feel that my father should be making payoffs to him for any construction work he did in the area.
Laura Garofalo is Eddie's youngest daughter. She cannot forget her father's murder and the man who did it.
I was completely in shock. My mother and my sister came running down, and it was just complete pandemonium.
When it came time to bury her dad, Laura said the family made the funeral a closed affair because they believed Gravano was going to attend.
His basic routine was to kill someone and then show up at the funeral and give a cash gift and stand over the family and say, if you need anything, I'm here for you.
Another victim was Roseanne Massa's brother, Michael DeBatt, who worked for the Gambino crime family. His suspected drug use made him a threat to the organization. There was concern he would become an informant. Gravano got rid of him.
He took people's lives. He became God. He became a judge. He became a jury. Maybe I'll kill this guy today. Maybe I'll kill this guy next week. It was always for his own gain. They put five bullets in the back of his head. But we had to be thankful for that, too, because they didn't put it in his face. We were able to have an open casket.
By 1990, Sammy the Bull had been involved in 19 murders. That was no secret to the FBI. They had kept close tabs on the leadership of the Gambino family. In fact, there was an FBI strike force specifically assigned to take down the leaders of La Cosa Nostra families in New York. And at the top of their list was John Gotti and his underboss, Sammy the Bull Gravano. Former FBI Special Agent James Moody was part of that strike force.
The Gambino family probably had around 350 identified members, as I recall, and probably close to 30 crews. So when we started looking at him, we wanted to go after the hierarchy of the families.
In 1990, while the FBI was closing in on Gotti and Gravano, Sammy the Bull was taking boxing lessons from Teddy Atlas, a trainer of world champs. What surprised Atlas was what Sammy the Bull revealed to him.
He made a comment that he wasn't afraid. And that told me volumes. I didn't have to see him handle a punch. That told me that this guy was very afraid. So I wound up saying, listen, all I know is that everyone's afraid. And a person who says they're not afraid is one of two things. They're either a liar or there's something wrong with them.
Knowing who Sammy the Bull was from the very beginning, Teddy Atlas felt uncomfortable being around him.
I knew that this guy, you know, obviously put people under the ground.
But what Atlas says worried him the most was what Sammy the Bull was telling him about his boss, John Gotti.
It's the last time I saw him. He came in the gym and he said, you know, Bo, he used to call people sometimes Bo. He said, the word is the government's gonna be coming down after me with an indictment. He said, they invade countries. He said, they're coming after me. He said, that can make you shake in your boots a little. And he said to me, they want me to betray my friend. And nobody can make you give up your dignity as a man, except yourself. Obviously, you shouldn't have been talking to me about that, but it's like he was trying to get me to help him convince himself that, or convince me, really, that he wouldn't do this.
In December 1990, the FBI arrested John Gotti, Sammy the Bull, and other Gambino crime family members. The electronic surveillance that had gone on for years finally paid off. The FBI now had recordings that revealed the innermost secrets of the Gambino family, and the person revealing them was none other than the boss himself, John Gotti. Even though they had hundreds of hours of incriminating surveillance tapes, the government still needed someone close to Gotti to testify against him. The last person the FBI expected to turn on Gotti was Sammy the Bull.
I think Sammy turned because Sammy's a very smart guy, and he was sitting there watching what was going on, and it dawned on him that John Gotti was going to blame him for everything and Gotti was going to walk. And Sammy decided that wasn't going to happen.
Ironically, it was John Gotti's own words that turned Sammy the Bull into the most famous government witness against Gotti and the mob.
Well, the way Sammy the Bull tells the story is that here he is. They have solid evidence. They have these tapes. The tapes are going to sink them. And what he had on John Gotti was his ticket out of jail. It was a get-out-of-jail free card. And he knew it.
At John Gotti's trial in 1992, Sammy the Bull's testimony sealed Gotti's fate. It took a jury only 13 hours to bring back a guilty verdict against Gotti. He was given a life sentence without parole and was sent to the federal supermax prison in Marion, Illinois. In April of 1993, Sammy the Bull made his first appearance on national television, testifying before a Senate subcommittee.
My name is Salvatore Gravano. Early in my life, I was given the nickname Sammy the Bull. I became a made member of the Gambino family in 1976. As part of my cooperation, I told the government about my life of crimes, including the fact that I participated in 19 murders.
Sammy the Bull Gravano then published a best-selling book, Underboss, about his killing spree. He went on television to promote it. Laura Garofalo's father, Eddie, was mentioned in Sammy's book.
Well, I read it from beginning to end. When he does talk about my father in the book, he says, we had to kill him. And that was it. It was a very brief mention. But he does talk excessively about this farm he had taken from my father and how the happiest moments of his life was this farm.
Laura Garofalo cannot forget that farm.
It was gut-wrenching for me because this farm was our farm. And in Sammy's book, he talks about this farm, and I'd sit on the porch, and I'd look down the rolling hills with grass, and these are my memories.
Despite Gravano's admission to 19 murders, the federal government locked him away for less than a year. As part of his deal with the government, Sammy the Bull was taken into the Witness Protection Program after promising never to violate the law again. He was given a new identity and was resettled with his family in a secret location. Some prosecutors called Gravano's deal of a lifetime. Coming up next, the Bull from Brooklyn turns up with a new name, a rich tan but still hustling, in the desert boomtown of Phoenix, Arizona. In 1996, Sammy the Bull Gravano arrived in Tempe, Arizona, a suburb of Phoenix. He was using a new name, Jimmy Moran, and he had a lot of cash. he had more than enough to bankroll a construction business, a pool installation company, and an Italian restaurant. But his new identity did not fool his neighbor across the street.
Car pull up, it was a realtor's car. Three people got out, the realtor, a woman, and a couple. I immediately recognized Sammy the Bull. I introduced myself and the general contractor in the neighborhood. He laughed. He said, well, I'm a contractor too. About 2 weeks later, my doorbell rang. I went and there he was. And he said, I bought the house. I'm gonna remodel it. You said you were a contractor. Let me hire you on a day-by-day basis and see what happens. I started the work, we started the demolition.
The prior owner had left the house uninhabitable.
It literally needed to be totally gutted. As we were going over the drawings, I said, well, aren't we gonna put any gun turrets on the corner? He just kind of looked, taken aback a little bit, and he laughed, and he, what do you mean? I go, well, what do you mean, what do I mean? He said, well, do you think you know who I am? I said, Jimmy, from the first day I saw you, I knew exactly who you were.
Gravano was building a mansion for his ex-wife, Deborah, and his family. He wanted his kids to be near him, and by treating his ex-wife to luxury, he ensured that. He spent nearly a year and a half and $500,000 making her happy.
Near the end of construction, when we were close, we were in the house one day. Debbie was standing on one side of a kitchen counter. His son Gerard was behind me and Sammy was off to my right. She said to me, Vince, I don't seem to have any water in this sink, hot water. And he responded with, well, how are you gonna fix it? And the more I talked about what had to be done, the madder he got. You know, he got hot, he got profane. And I said, look, I've told you this before, I'm telling you again, you don't know about construction. At that, he charged me. And, you know, and when they call him Sammy the Bull, boy, you get that impression.
What came next was classic Sammy the Bull.
He stuck a gun in my head, boink. And I looked at Debbie, and she had color drained from her. Her jaw was open. I could hear Gerard behind me going, Dad, Dad, Dad. And he said, you know, you're not going to make me go back. And I said, nobody makes anybody do anything. You know, we're all agents of free will. And he left.
Gravano walked away because he didn't want to attract the police. The reason, he had broken his agreement with the federal government. He started dealing drugs, and members of his family were working for him. Meanwhile, in New York City, customs agents were alarmed by the growth of the illegal ecstasy trade.
Tremendous profit margin made overseas at pennies a pill. Import value at the time when smuggled in the United States, about $7 a tab. And in the clubs in the large metropolitan areas around the country, a tablet of ecstasy will go from $25 to $35 a tablet.
Drug dealers were moving ecstasy from New York to Phoenix. In Phoenix, Arizona, local police sergeant Jim Cope and detective Ron Sterrett were leading a probe into an ecstasy drug ring.
Middle to upper class kids of every race. It was just amazing. It was a drug fest. And I think that we were one of the first agencies at the time in the nation that was doing something so aggressive undercover work with ecstasy.
Soon, Cope and his partner, Sterrett, were focusing in on the big ecstasy dealer.
Bad guys on the street were telling my undercover guys the ecstasy was being controlled by the Italian mobsters from New York. We got contacted by a source of information who informed me that Michael Papa was very involved in the moving of the large amounts of ecstasy. And I knew he was an Italian from New York, so I kind of thought we were going in the right direction.
That made Mike Papa a prime target. He worked at Marathon Construction, a company run by Sammy the Bull.
I was shocked. The kids that we were looking at had no other finances in their background, but they're driving Infinities, they're driving brand new Lexuses. I mean, they're going to clubs, they're treated like royalty.
One criminal source had Mike Papa's phone number. That was a major breakthrough.
We had subpoenaed the subscriber information on the phone that Mike Papa was using, and learned at that time that that specific phone, which was serviced by Nextel, was subscribed to Marathon Construction and Debbie Gravano, and it had a list of employees that had the Nextels and the radio features.
It now appeared that Marathon Construction was a front for an ecstasy drug operation. Then, Sergeant Cope received a stunning tip from a drug informant.
This information source figured I'd think he was crazy. He told me, he goes, well, you're not going to believe it, but have you ever heard of Sammy the Bull, Sammy the Bull Gravano? And I'm from the East Coast, and I said, yeah, I know of him. And he said, yeah, he's supposed to be out here financing and running the whole show. So the next day, driving into work, I contacted some people and did some research and found out that Salvador Gravano was indeed living in Arizona.
The federal government hadn't told the Phoenix police that Sammy the Bull had relocated in their jurisdiction. But now they knew, and the puzzling pieces of their investigation suddenly made sense. Sammy the Bull was the real New York mobster who was controlling the ecstasy trade. After all the suspects that Cope and Sterrett had been watching were reporting to some big man and had phones that were listed in the name of Deborah Gravano. Ron Sterrett decided to go out to Marathon Construction and check things out.
About 7 o'clock in the morning, it was light. Sammy pulled up in his Lexus and got out of his Lexus and walked into the front door.
What the Phoenix task force now needed were wiretap warrants, the permission to bug Marathon Construction and other places where Sammy the Bull hung out. And in Arizona, the Attorney General signs off on such requests.
I had no knowledge that he was actually here. And so the first thing I want to know is this the same man that had testified against the mafia in New York? And once I was assured it was, I thought to myself, this guy, he's not in it for fun and games. This is a conspiracy case. And he's trying to do his own deal out here, and we're not going to let him. We're just not going to let him.
Sammy the Bull Gravano was once again the target of a criminal investigation. And his deal of a lifetime was now in jeopardy. Next on Mugshots, Sammy the Bull caught on tape again. By late December 1999, Sammy the Bull's office phone at his construction company was tapped. So was the phone at his restaurant, where his wife Debbie worked. The same was true for all the cell phones that were registered to his businesses. And soon, Cope and Sterrett knew more about Sammy the Bull's ecstasy operation than Gravano himself.
Hello? I just told Mommy, she said to call you. That's $70 for the gas receipt?
Yeah.
Up to you.
Can she do it right away?
Yeah, she said not a problem. Just make sure it's right with you to reimburse them.
Yeah.
All right.
This wiretapped conversation between Sammy the Bull and his son Gerard was in code, as were many such calls. $70 translated to $70,000 in cash, and the mention of the gas receipt, that stood for the drug ecstasy. In another wiretapped phone call, Sammy accuses his wife, Deborah, of stealing.
Uncle Sal, can I help you?
Yeah. What did you send me?
What did I send you?
Yeah. No.
What?
No.
No?
No.
Yeah.
No. We just counted it. I'm going to give it another count as soon as I get people out of the way. It's 65. I just asked Karen. Karen said she got it. Went from her hand to me in the drawer. 65.
All right, well, could have made a mistake. I doubt it.
Well, I'm going to give a recount as soon as I get people out of my face.
All right.
That leaves me suspect that you must have robbed these people the last time.
All right. Then I'll have to double check when I go home.
Double check. Do whatever you want. And I didn't take it.
Sammy the Bull's crew were on their Nextel phones night and day, talking away to each other as if they were the only ones in the world listening. They were all using Nextel phones because it was Sammy the Bull's phone of choice.
Sammy felt if they conducted their drug business or any type of business over a Nextel phone, that you can't wiretap Nextel phones because the FBI uses Nextel phones.
That wasn't true, but that's what Sammy the Bull believed at the time.
The cops in Arizona made hundreds of hours of wiretaps of Sammy talking to various people, among them former FBI agents and also a fellow mob rat by the name of Fat Dom Borghese. Sammy and Dom talking about the fact that they cooperated and became rats.
if a guy says, I'm a stand-up guy, and he does 100 years, me personally, and he has a way of getting out, I think he's a fool. I don't give him credit.
But I don't give him credit either, because if the life is so double-cross type of thing, it's so treacherous, it's so vicious, it's so everything, these guys ain't rats. These guys are just being double-crossed, and they're double-crossing back.
This conversation with Fat Dom and others like it would prove devastating to Sammy the Bull down the line. One reason Sammy the Bull was keeping in touch with Fat Dom was that he wanted him to come down to Arizona and go to work for him.
Sammy had big plans. He talked about putting together his own organized crime family in Arizona, the Arizona Mafia, the Arizona family. And he was going to have these young kids. They weren't all going to be Italian. They weren't all going to have killed somebody. He was going to have the first African-American member. And he was going to have a few of the heavy hitters, as he put it, from the old days, people who had killed other people, be members of the crew.
This wiretapped conversation between Sammy the Bull's employee, Michael Papa, and a drug dealer showed there were large sums of money generated by the Gravano ecstasy operation.
I just took it all out and counted it all together, you know what I mean? There was like 55,201 or $100 bills, there were 20,050s.
I wish he would have gave you that paper, because on the paper I wrote down how much was in the box. That's weird that it came out with such a weird number like that.
Yeah, it was $130,670.
Phoenix police had been monitoring and recording all phone calls of Sammy the Bull's businesses and employees. They suspected that Sammy the Bull was the big man controlling the ecstasy market in Phoenix.
The big man said $750 for us. You know what I mean? Like, we're paying $750 for him.
Right.
If I flip him for $750, we make nothing.
Right.
Remember I told you our guy raised our price? He raised our price a quarter, so.
The cops now had evidence that Sammy the Bull was the big man, setting the price for ecstasy in the Phoenix area, that even Mike Papa was working for him.
We could see how tight Mike Papa was to Sammy and the family. We could see the relationship with Gerard. Right away, it established that Gerard, Mike Papa, and David Seabrook were the three primary guys.
In addition to the wiretaps, there were bugs. A bug right in Sammy's office.
He used to sit in the corner. The guys would sit around, either in a semicircle or on a couch that he had in his office. And he would tell them about the old days. And he would give them crime-evading tips. Never do a hit with an automatic. Always use a revolver. Automatic's my jam. Never keep the drugs and the money together. Always keep them separate. These guys, they met Sammy, and they were in awe. He was like a rock star to them.
The listening device in Sammy the Bull's office was difficult to monitor because of Gravano's constant companion, his miniature Doberman Pinscher, Petey.
That thing barks all the time, no matter where he's at. It was nerve-wracking for the guys listening to the phone because Petey would be in the background barking when Sammy's talking.
Sergeant Cope had his personal run-in with Sammy the Bull Gravano and Petey at a traffic light. Cope was driving a fancy Mercedes that he was using as part of his cover to throw off the targets he was pursuing. The Mercedes worked like a charm.
I had pulled up in the Mercedes right next to Sammy, and he was going to Uncle Sal's to meet Debbie at, you know, where he hung out at night. And I pulled up right next to him at a stoplight, and I looked over, and Petey went ballistic, barking at me. I almost thought, this dog knows who I am and watching, you know, the dog knows what's going on, Sammy doesn't. And Sammy looked at me, and I think he said, this dog, huh? He barks too much. And I said, yeah, I think barks. And never had a clue, and, you know, just kept driving on.
Next on Mugshots, cops move in for the kill. Whatever luck Sammy the Bull had enjoyed in the past was now deserting him. But the Phoenix police were only part of his problem. On the streets, Sammy the Bull's ecstasy drug operation was about to come up against some competition. And back in New York, U.S. Customs had begun investigating another major ecstasy importer and distributor.
We began to target a gentleman by the name of Alan Zarger. And through that investigation, we identified a number of mules, as we refer to them as couriers, that would be bringing in, concealed mostly in luggage in this organization, in suitcases, 30, 40,000 tablets at a time.
U.S. Customs agents now had enough evidence to secure a wiretap warrant on Zarger, and began picking up some fascinating conversations. Zarger, for example, had distributors and dealers in Arizona, and soon they came face to face with Gravano's crew.
It became a turf war, if you would, over the controlling the ecstasy market in the Phoenix area between Mr. Zarger and Sammy the Bull. And Sammy the Bull had actually, they had beaten up an associate of Mr. Zarger's.
Word of this attack got back to Zarger in New York, and Zarger was no one to fool with. He sent a hitman to Arizona to kill Sammy the Bull. In the end, there was no need to take Sammy the Bull out. Instead, there was a sit-down in the back of Uncle Sal's restaurant. A deal was cut to allow Zarger to operate on Sammy the Bull's turf, as long as Gravano got a cut on every tablet sold by Zarger in the Phoenix Valley. Months later, Zarger would prove to be a devastating connection for Sammy the Bull, and the direct link needed to make him a federal target in the Eastern District of New York, in the very U.S. Attorney's Office in Brooklyn, where he had once gotten the fabled pass of a lifetime.
The irony was not lost on anyone that the nexus was going to be made right here in New York, that Sammy, probably without even knowing it, was being supplied by a crew that was based in New York. He probably would never have done that knowingly. If he realized that these kids were getting supplied out in New York, he probably would have put a stop to it.
Sammy the Bull's days were now numbered in Arizona, but Sammy the Bull was clueless. He just went on doing what he had been doing, talking his head off in his back office, relying on wannabe wise guys to protect his involvement in the very organization he was building and leading and financing in Arizona.
One of the mistakes he made was that he forgot that because he was such a powerful figure in the organization, that members of his crew were going to talk about him. And although he instructed them not to talk about him by name, they would still talk about him, and they'd refer to him as the boss and the big man.
That was by no means the only mistake Sammy the Bull made in Arizona. He also started to talk about murder with one of his ecstasy suppliers. The target was the chemist whose lab was manufacturing ecstasy for Gravano.
Sammy started to have discussions about taking this chemist out. In other words, overtaking the plant so they would control the ecstasy on every level. And this is one of the events that led the kids to realize he is also a killer.
Talk of murder frightened Gravano's crew. The Bull stopped being cool and became too dangerous to be around. He even said he wanted to murder Ron Kuby, a New York lawyer.
Ron Kuby represented some of the victims' families of the people that Sammy had either killed or had participated in their killings in a lawsuit to recover profits from the book Underboss.
And this was not just fanciful speculation, it was planned in great detail. The idea was to lure me to San Antonio with the promise of a big case. And once I got to San Antonio, the only case I was going to get was a bad case of lead poisoning.
Sammy the Bull's empire was unraveling. Sources had tipped off Sergeant Cope and Detective Sterrett to a planned drug deal with a supplier flying in from Los Angeles and a buyer arriving from Cleveland. The exchange was brokered by one of Sammy the Bull's crew, making sure that things went off synchronized to the second at the Phoenix airport. But Cope and Sterrett knew their every move. Next, on Mugshots, Cope and Sterrett take down Sammy the Bull. By the end of January 2000, Sammy the Bull Gravano was the target of two rapidly closing investigations, a federal probe in New York and the Arizona case in Phoenix.
We were walking on eggshells. We didn't want a lot of people to know about the case. Gravano had just left the witness protection program, and, you know, we knew that he had ongoing relations with the FBI. And it was our decision then that, hey, we're not going to disclose this case to the FBI or anybody until the case was completed.
They came for Sammy the Bull early on the morning of February 24th, 2000, and they caught him asleep. A SWAT team burst into his Tempe apartment through the front and back doors.
It was as high a risk entry as you can make. They had woke him up. He was on the floor crawling towards his jacket, reaching for his jacket. That's where all his guns were his jacket.
That same morning, across the Arizona Valley, some 300 detectives, agents, and law enforcement officials, in synchronized precision raids, seized Sammy the Bull's entire organization. Among those arrested were his wife, Deborah, his son, Gerard, his daughter, Karen, her boyfriend, and scores of others.
You could hear the helicopters coming into position. You know, and it's, a quiet morning. You hear that sound. They're at the side of the house, dressed as SWAT team members with their protective clothing, dark ski mask type situation. They broke the doors front and rear, and they were climbing over the walls, and they handcuffed Debbie and Karen, and they took the cars.
The strategy that morning had been to take down Sammy the Bull first, so he could be processed and immediately shipped off to jail.
We were going to get him through the processing at the command post and get him tucked away in Madison Street Jail before he had contact with any of the other co-defendants, because we were in fear that, you know, he would intimidate people just the mere sight of him.
Within half an hour, Sammy the Bull was face to face with investigators Cope and Sterrett.
I think he recognized me right away, and it was just going through his mind all the times he saw me, and maybe even spoke to me on surveillance. And I could see his mind click, and I knew right away he knew. I think he knew. And his mind was racing how much did we got on him.
I introduced myself to Mr. Gravano at that time and told him the charges that he was being arrested for, which was, at that point, one count of conspiracy to distribute dangerous drugs. When I told Mr. Gravano that, he kind of leaned his head back and went, oh.
Even in this court appearance in Phoenix, Sammy the Bull had no clue as to what the state and federal authorities had in store for him.
There is no violence in this case that I'm charged with, that I'm aware of. And I'm in the community, I'm part of the community, I'm in business. I run a couple of businesses in Arizona. I've never ran from a case in my life. And this is basically, in my history of crime, this is a minor thing.
Sammy the Bull was wrong again. It wasn't minor, and it wouldn't go away. After his arrest in Arizona, he was extradited to Brooklyn, New York, to face federal drug charges. Assistant U.S. Attorney Linda Lacewell remembers their first meeting.
He just was staring at me the entire time, but I didn't want to have a staring contest with him. What I learned later was Gravano was trying to make a decision, and to do that, he needed to figure out his adversary, and that was me. And he needed to know whether or not he could take me on, and he decided that he could.
Wow. Oh my God. There's no doubt that the arrest of Sammy the Bull in Arizona for running this ecstasy ring, it was a major embarrassment for the prosecutors in Brooklyn. They had gone out on a limb for him. They had gotten him this extremely sweet deal for his involvement in 19 murders. They took a lot of heat over the deal that he got. And it didn't really get better when Sammy was out there peddling this book and not really showing any remorse for what he had done. So at the same time, I think the wheels in their brains were turning, and they're thinking, geez, you know, how can we pay this guy back? Because he really made us look bad. He's disgraced the federal government.
He demanded a speedy trial in federal court, which means he had to go to trial very quickly, within a couple of months. And he thought we would not be ready, and we were.
In fact, he never went to trial at all in New York or Arizona. The reason? Some of his trusted lieutenants had flipped on him.
Gravano was the most famous turncoat in modern times, and the best lesson that these kids got from him, they took a page right out of his playbook and cooperated and assisted in the prosecution and conviction of him.
Sammy the Bull Gravano pleaded guilty to federal drug charges in New York and received the maximum sentence, 20 years in prison. He was then returned to Phoenix, Arizona to be sentenced on the state drug charges. Coming up next, Sammy's final public appearance. John Gotti died of throat cancer in prison on June 10th, 2002. 4 months later, Sammy the Bull Gravano, the Brooklyn Wise Guy, John Gotti's legendary hitman, made a final quiet appearance in a small Phoenix courtroom.
He used his family for the purpose of financial gain. And what did we end up with? A son who now is going to do 9 years in prison. A daughter that now has a felony record to her credit, and a wife, she now has a felony conviction too.
Two women who were not in the courtroom that day felt special relief when they heard the news of Sammy's fall.
I'm happy that he's in jail, and I'm happy that in some small way he's suffering, because this is a man who did anything to stay out of jail. So I know that was a big issue for him. I know that that was something that, with all his might, he tried to avoid.
I just sat and smiled. I said, good. It's good. And then my niece saw it, and she called up hysterical crying, because she knew this man was responsible for her father's murder.
For the cops who did the work to nail him, getting Gravano was the case of a lifetime.
It was a great day for the Customs Service. This is a high-level violator. Ecstasy was a big problem at the time. We had made some serious inroads.
What may be Sammy the Bull's final public appearance came before the sentencing judge on October 30, 2002.
As you stand here today, I know that you fully appreciate the fact that you are going to be sentenced to a long term in prison. As a result of your decision to become involved in this, that you have forfeited the right to continue living in the society which you have continually preyed upon since you were a young man. So is there anything that you wish to say this morning?
I believe you in this court have been very fair with me and my family, and I appreciate it very much.
Always my thought with him is, you couldn't be content with what you had. You just couldn't walk away. You were able to walk away. What made you do it? He walked out, he said, see you, Sam, have a good life. But he didn't have on that expensive suit anymore. He didn't have marshals carrying his luggage anymore. He had the blue shoes that they give you in jail. He had his bald head. He decided to also destroy his family. I guess the evil is just so abundant in him now at this point in his life that he took his whole family with him this time.
Sammy the Bull Gravano is serving 20 years hard time in a federal supermax prison on concurrent federal and state drug charges.